our last class of TV 402. My name is Jeff Miller. As you can see at the bottom of the screen, my name is Paul Spencer. Today is December 9th, and I am looking forward to wrapping up our semester with a special guest. But before we introduce her, I wanted to make sure that we go over a few basic pieces, do some housekeeping, and start getting you thinking about your questions that you are going to call in with tonight or text in with tonight. And again, as you know, the best way to get your question addressed and have a discussion is to call in. The number, as you can see, is 800-339-1193. Please give us phone calls. I'm going to detail some of the things you might want to think about when you think about calling in. And I'm going to urge you to do that. A couple of quick announcements. One is the test update. I inadvertently typed the wrong course name on the top of the study guide for you. So for those of you that have been emailing me and saying, oh my god, this says the wrong course, that was my fault. The study guide is correct. The one that you have. Speaking of that, many of you have texted in and said, well, what about the test? What's happening with the test? And the test will be released and ready for you to take at the end of the class tonight. The deal with the test is it's a new format. It's what I'm trying to finalize for the semester. So I'm looking forward to seeing how this works. Basically, the format is this. There's going to be 50 questions. You have a total of 1 hour and 15 minutes total to take the test. The deal with it is this, is it's online, and it's a timed test, so you have an hour and 15 minutes, but basically the trick with it is this, as long as you answer a question, you can't go back and change your answer, you keep moving forward. If by any chance you get knocked off of the internet, go back on, log back on, your time clock continues to work, and so you won't lose track of time. The reason why we don't just have it open for the whole week is to really do a good check of knowledge. So for those of you that looked at the study guide is pretty comprehensive. If you know those things, then you should do you should do fine on this. And the test scores, once you finish, I believe, do go directly into Blackboard. So once you finish and you hit submit or finish test, you can go online in a little while. I don't know the exact time, and you can see how you did. So with that, that will conclude the majority of you for the course. So this is our last class. What do I need from you today? I need lots of participation. I would hope that many of you are going to call in specifically with questions about special education. Many of you over the course of the semester through email and through phone calls and through office hour visits have come in. We've had a good conversation about special education, and I know many of you are concerned about how do I reach these children with special needs? What do I call these children with special needs? What is it going to look like? How do I identify them? So what we are going to address is about 7 things tonight. For example, we're going to address what is special education. We're going to talk about something called people first language. We're going to identify for you the most frequent disabilities that we see in the classroom. So we're going to talk about what inclusion is, what full inclusion is. We're going to talk about identification issues. How do you identify? What do you as a classroom teacher look for? Fifth, we're going to talk a little bit about response to intervention. We're also going to talk about what you as a teacher can do and how to engage parents. So now that I've been in you, you can start thinking about what you want to call in for. And if you can't tell, I'm planning on seeing that light up soon with your phone calls. I'm going to take this time to introduce an old friend of mine and a professor at Cal State Penance Hills who has been teaching the special ed program here for somewhere, I believe, around 8 years. And her name is Dr. Kate Esposito. She is an associate professor at Cal State Penance Hills. And I'd like to welcome, there she is, and I would like to welcome her. And so, Kate, welcome.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. I look forward to answering any of the questions you have, and I will be as specific as I can, depending upon your questions. So, we really welcome any questions or any concerns that you have, and again, it's a pleasure to be here.
So, the format for the efforts is as they might have known, as a professional, I'd like to get to play host and ask you some questions. So, I'm going to come out of the gate and literally ask whether it's going to talk about this or assume anything, don't make any assumptions. And so if you can, tell the students or tell me, I would say, is what should teachers understand about how to define what special education really is?
There's been a lot of changes in the field, but probably the biggest one is that we really consider special education a delivery of services. It's no longer a place where we would send students to a special education classroom, but instead it's services. Does the student need help with reading skills? Does the student need help with their speech and language? Does the student need extended time on a test? So, or does the student need more intervention in the general education classroom? So we really look at it as terms of a wraparound service instead of just a place.
How are here's the things that you and I know, always have a pretty little bit of my background in motivation, your background special question I get from people all the time, and I've asked you this question, so I'm asking you now, which is kids are really, really, really far behind. Or kids with special needs. And I know that one of the things that we've spoken about in this course is that you can't, but it's not really appropriate to say that the special ed child, because it's a huge spectrum. But bottom line, what's the difference between a kid that's 6 years below grade level in ninth grade and a student with special needs?
Well, oftentimes the student can be significantly below grade level because he or she has special needs. So the difference would be that there's a spectrum of students involved within the special education category. You can have a very high functioning student who actually is doing much better, is actually higher than the average performance student without a disability, and you can have on the other end of the spectrum a student who is significantly below his or her peers. Some students will always be below their peers. Some students may never ever catch up in reading or writing or even independent living. Those are people who would consider more on the moderate severe range, but then some of our students who we consider to be the more mild moderate will actually far exceed.
Let me jump in, because that's the thing that always confuses a lot of the general ed students, which is how do we, in California, separate this, I don't know if it's from the severity of special ed or learning disability, or you just mentioned moderate, severe, mild, moderate, what are the breakdowns?
Okay, so we have two different categories, or general categories of disability. We have what's called the mild moderate, and those categories tend to be, probably the easiest way to think about it, are those of the students who are working on the general education curriculum. And we're just looking at modifying the curriculum to meet those students' needs. Then we have what's called the moderate severe. Those disabilities tend to be what we would also call low incidence. Those are categories such as severe cognitive and intellectual disabilities. Maybe they have deafness, maybe they have multiple disabilities. So it's a continuum. We don't say that somebody has a learning disability. That doesn't tell us what the range is. Is it a severe learning disability? Is it a moderate disability? And to what extent would that impact the students achieving in the general education classroom? Also, as a point of clarification, it's important that whenever we talk about disabilities within an academic setting, we're talking about their ability to, or how their disability impacts student achievement, and then how that might impact life after school in a post-secondary setting. So everything is specific to how does a disability impact their ability to access the general education curriculum.
There's a lot of questions that people have about special education. In fact, before I take our first phone call, I heard a really good thing. First question I'll ask is, where do students that are deaf fall? That's a whole other category, isn't
it? It's what we would call a low incidence disability. It would, again, depend upon where that student is. I have seen classrooms where you have students who have severe hearing loss and who only sign, that are cognitively, they have typical cognitive and intellectual development. So then the only accommodation we're making for that student is within the general education setting, and perhaps they have an interpreter. Now we have online high schools. Maybe they're taking classes online. Maybe that's the only impact that disability has, or perhaps that disability is going to child with a disability is individualized. There aren't any broad generalizations. Not all students who are deaf, we can't put them into a nice shoebox and say, well, this is what this is going to be like. Not all students who have visual impairments, we don't know because it's a continuum. And then there's other factors such as cognitive and intellectual development.
And we're going to hammer these points out as we go through our head. And again, before I take this call, I have a reason why I said so. I have two deaf students in my course that I teach here at USL last night. And I was speaking with one of the interpreters that was in the room. And it was interesting. So I asked her, what is the most unique question that you ever got from a deaf student or a deaf student? And she said that the question she got from the student that gave me goosebumps when she said that it was about an 8-year-old child who said, who asked her, what sound does the sun make? And she did not say what she meant. And the person, well, I've been told when the wind comes through trees, it makes a sound. And when the rain makes a sound, what sound does the sun make? And that hit. And I've known my cousins worked with these students for years and years and years. It never hit me how profound what they just did out of that question. So, change gears a little bit. Let's take our first call. I don't want to make you move too long. So, we have Isadora calling from Westchester. Isadora, what do you got?
My question is, I work with a language class where a special ed student comes into the classroom. His behavior in the language class is not great, but I've seen him in his special education class, and he's far worse in that classroom. So what can, I'm not sure what the reason is, but what can be done to, I guess, adjust the behavior that he's displaying in the special ed class?
Well, I would, first of all, just as an outside perspective, I would ask myself, if just like any of our students, some students have excellent behavior in one class, and maybe they go to their science class and they don't have good behavior. And ultimately, the teacher does bear some responsibility for that, because even if that teacher's not modifying instruction, that teacher's not engaging the student. So it might not, it's not necessarily a problem that's inherent with the student as much as it is with the classroom environment. So for you, since you as a language teacher, you obviously have developed some good strategies that are effective with the student. You have some good behavior management strategies. And I'm not sure how long you've been teaching, but it might be that you're a more experienced teacher. So as a teacher, your role is just to ensure that the instruction that you're providing within your own classroom is meeting that student's need. If the student is having behavior problems in other educational settings, I'm not sure that it would be appropriate for you to intervene unless that other teacher came to you and said, I notice that the student does really well in your classroom. What is it that you do with that student that is so effective, and how can I implement that in my classroom?
Are you still there, Isadora?
Thank you.
Well, you have
Do that help, or do you have a follow-up?
Well, it helps a little bit, but I'm just more curious as to why his behavior is so different, and I honestly think that the teacher in his special ed class does a great job, but he seems to mimic the behavior of the other students in that classroom. So I don't know.
Well, I think part of it also is I think what you're saying is spot on, which is it depends on the teacher and the teacher's expectations, and also the teachers and both teachers' abilities to understand what the needs of that specific student are. That also, the one thing that I've seen over and over and over again is that general education teachers really don't, to the level that they need to, they don't understand the resource that special education teachers can offer. Let me explain that. What I mean is that general education teachers are trained to be content experts. That doesn't mean that you are not a good teacher. Special education teachers are taught to identify where the gap is in student learning and be able to generate an effective teaching strategy that will close that gap and be able to assess its effectiveness. So you really start to see how these things can come together. And then both the general ed teacher and the specialist teacher come together. It's one of the reasons why Dr. Esposito and I have done some work together, simply because there's areas that are called co-teaching, where you bring special education teachers together with general education teachers. We're going to be talking about that a little bit when we get to inclusion. But what I really want to make sure of before you hang up is that if you have any other questions, follow-up questions, that we can use this point to discuss. So I just want to make sure you're good. So any other, what other questions might you have? Are you on this one?
I'm sorry, what was the last part of that
question? I want to make sure before you hang up that you have your questions answered. So if you have,
I think so. I think maybe a discussion with the specialist would probably help me understand a little more. So,
Can I just add in one point? I think it's also important to remember for all of our students that school is not a choice. They don't get to choose to come to school. School is obligatory. And that school environment can either be really wonderful for that student or it can be very challenging. And so the student has a history of success. And maybe the student in your particular classroom has a history of success. Your class is much more enjoyable to go to. Whereas if the student does not have a history of success, of course, they're not going to want to be in that classroom necessarily. So I think that's always important to remember, is how is that classroom affecting the student's self-esteem or self-efficacy. And I think it's also important to consider that for many of our students, by the time that they have either been identified as needing special ed or by the time that they are in the later years of school, that they don't have a strong history of success, and that it is our obligation to enable them to be successful.
Cool, and thank you for calling. Isidore, I want to take a couple of these texts for a couple of weeks. I want to make sure, because in the last class, we can really try to get through some of these questions. And Michelle Morrison has a question that usually comes up, which has to do with bottom line questions, like what's the ADHD, it seems like it's over-diagnosed, and how is it determined to need special help? I think underlying your question is, really, what do we know about ADHD? What is the information that general education might need to know about that?
Well, first of all, any time that a student's going to receive services, they have gone through a process, a systematic process. It is part of that referral and what we would call identification. So a student, because another component to remember is that special education is a category and funding is tied to it. Lots of students would benefit from receiving small group instruction, but not all students qualify for that. So the students that do qualify that need to fall within certain categories, what we call disability categories. Attention deficit hyperactivity can be tied to funding, specific learning disabilities, intellectual and cognitive disabilities, vision loss, hearing loss. Those are all specific categories, and there are actually state regulations and federal regulations that define how severe that needs to be. The bottom line with any of these disabilities is that they need to impact educational achievement. So I'm going to go back to your example earlier that you spoke about having a student at the college level who had a hearing loss. His school was categorized as deaf. He didn't necessarily need any other intervention other than to have an interpreter with him. His disability beyond that was not impacting his educational achievement, so he had very minimal services that were provided to him. A student who was placed into a specialized setting who needs more is going to have more services to enable him or her to be successful, and that's going to vary. So, with that said, then there is a process to qualify for special ed. And generally speaking, you need to be at least 2 grade levels or 2 standard deviations below the mean in academic achievement to qualify as needing special ed. In general, that's a very broad general statement either with specific learning disabilities, and with other disabilities, it's very, very specific to that disability.
Is ADD overdiagnosed, or is it not overdiagnosed but over-referred?
The research is pretty clear with regard to two areas. There tends to be what we would say over-identification within the category of students who are identified as having attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. The largest percentage is males. So we might say that more males are diagnosed with this than over-identification, because the counter to that is that females tend to be under-identified. There is no reason that we would expect males to have a higher percentage of that. It's just that it might be manifested differently, and so that many females may have that and need assistance, but because their manifestations are not to the extent that they are with males, they're not as identified.
You sort of talk about things like accommodations, and you mentioned a word that education is individualized, and the piece that I wanted to get from you tonight was Individuals with Disabilities and Education Act. How, from your seat, would you describe individuals with disabilities education for what the idea is?
Okay, so the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act is a federal law. Each state interprets that, but in some idea ensures that all children who have special needs are identified. In other words, it's incumbent upon the school to identify students who have a disability and who need special education services. Then there is also the least restrictive environment. Under IDEA, all students are guaranteed the right to be educated in the least restrictive environment. Most interpret that to mean to the maximum extent possible with their general education peers.
By least restrictive, and I know this, I'm just going to ask you this, by least restrictive, that means that the least restrictive is to be what's called mainstream all day.
For some, that can depend. Some students will have the least restrictive. Some students, let's take the most extreme example. A student has significant health problems that impact his or her academic achievement, and that student is hospitalized. So the least restrictive environment for that student might be in a hospital room with a special education itinerant teacher who comes out to visit him or her and who conducts instruction within that classroom, and that might be the least restrictive environment for him or her.
I wanted to know for him, but just in general, if you were to look at life.
Most feel that the general education is the least restrictive environment.
And by law, the children have to be in for them, which is generated. How do they determine what the least restrictive environment is for individuals?
So every student, so let me go back to the idea. So because I'm going to come back to what the least restrictive environment is. So IDEA guarantees four or five basic rights for students. One is that they will have their disability identified, and that they'll receive a free and appropriate special education to meet their needs, and that they'll be educated in the least restrictive environment. That placing or providing services for students with special needs is always a team decision. It's not just you and I in the back room deciding that Johnny's a really bad student and we're just going to shoot him off, and we're going to give him special ed services, and we're going to label him as having a cognitive disability. And part of that team is always the parent, and when appropriate, the student. And if parents don't agree with the decision that the IEP team has come to, they have procedural and due process rights. So a student would never, ever be qualified for receiving special ed unless there was a team of teachers. And that team are a team of professionals, and that team includes teachers, parents, psychologists. In the case of students who have attention deficit hyperactivity, that also tends to be sometimes a medical personnel. It could be the school nurse, it could be somebody else. So it's never an isolated decision, it's always a team decision. And then at that decision, at that meeting, you determine where that student's needs are best met. So we don't say a student has attention deficit hyperactivity respond to it, especially in the city for any percent of the day. We base it on what the team feels the best way, that student's needs.
And that comes out in the IED?
Yes, after much discussion, and the parent can always, there's always procedure of process if the parent doesn't agree with that.
Okay, excellent. So now, let me just tackle one of the other questions we have here from Teresa Lemos, because it was a kindergarten specific. And she says that, I work with kindergarten, and we have a student who does not seem to learn because he talks to himself a lot. Yesterday, I asked him for letter knowledge, and surprise, surprise, I think it means he knew or she knew them all. So from now on, I seem to see him differently. There it is. He's talking, does not bother me much, so I'm going to repeat this question. Why do you send someone to talk to themselves in kindergarten? I don't know if that's necessarily a special education, because
that's a self-regulation.
Yeah, it might be, they'll still be five.
They're self-regulation. They prefer to learn information auditorily. They're regulating, they're monitoring.
Okay, and then Laura asked a question that kind of goes what we were talking about right before we went on here. Which says, out of curiosity, with the budget cuts that many districts are facing, with special ed programs get cut as well. What have you heard or thought about that?
That's a loaded question. There is significant legal precedent suggesting that finance or fiscal budgets or anything of that do not be a reason to deny special ed. So a school district can never say, well, we know that Sarah needs a nurse to come to school with her every day because she's on a respirator. A school can never say, well, we just can't have her attending school. Because it's always considered a free, appropriate public education. And the goal is always to send a student to their home school or the school that they would otherwise attend. So we never look at it from a financial perspective. So I'm not sure what the impact is going to be. I think that I see it definitely as a civil rights and as a social justice issue, that those who are students who are the most needy, so we need to ensure that we adhere to our obligations to meet the students' needs.
You know, with regard to specific budget, you know, you never know what exactly the, you know, government is thinking or looking at it. The numbers seem to change every day about what's going to be cut and how much is going to be cut. And, you know, what was mean to you one teacher, one Saturday. So that's a fair question, a good question. The second thing I wanted to talk to you about is to sort of circle back and get into all these pieces is what is people first language? What does that mean?
So it's important to remember that the bottom line is that an individual who has a disability is not a disabled individual. They are an individual first. So instead of saying that you have a learning disabled student, that student is first of all a student who has a learning disability. We always seek to look at the individual and not their disability. It's important also to remember that the difference between a disability and what we might call a handicapping condition. In other words, a person, and I'm going to go back to your example of the individual who was deaf, hard of hearing, who's in your university class. That person's disability does not impact them, provided that we make the accommodation of giving them an interpreter. If you didn't have an interpreter, then that person would have a disability that would impact their achievement. But because we provided that, then they have access to your college class and they have greater access in the integration into society as a whole.
And later on, as we get into this little bit, some pieces that you're wondering, this is so much information. What do I really do as a teacher? We're going to get to that in a little bit, so we're not going to leave you hanging. So I see those are important pieces, but as we start to look at what really is impacting the teachers in terms of what the most frequent disabilities are, how do you, what are the most frequent?
Occurring disabilities are the categories. So I'm going to start with autism. That's probably the one that we hear the most about. And rates of identification certainly suggest that one in every 150 children born are identified with autism. Now, autism, again, like we said earlier, there's a spectrum. You can look on the very, very high end of autism, and that's what we would call Asperger's. And you can look to the other side of the spectrum, where you would have much lower functioning students who maybe are not verbal, maybe who have cognitive and developmental disabilities. So it's a spectrum. So autism right now is the most frequently diagnosed disability. What most teachers will see, particularly who are general education teachers, those of you who teach, sorry, they're not yours, Jeff, but those of you that are teaching, most likely you're going to see students who are identified as having a specific learning disability, students who receive speech and language services, and students who have what we might identify as other health impairments, or students who come under ADHD or attention deficit disorder. And those are tied, that's what we would call our high incidence disabilities, and those are have the greatest number of students who receive services under the special ed umbrella.
Okay, so in terms of specific learning disabilities, what might that
Well, there's different types of specific learning disability. You can have a visual processing disability. You can have an auditory processing disability. The bottom line is that a student who should have above average performance is not performing commensurate with things in their ability. So we would say, as a general rule for a student who has specific learning disabilities, that they have average to above average intelligence, and their performance is not average to above average, so that their ability and their achievement is not commensurate. That's one model for looking at learning disabilities, or without getting into the whole RTI and alternative forms of diagnosis. But in general, their specific learning disabilities, these are students who are very, very capable, who are not achieving commensurate with their ability.
And one of the pieces that I know that we've talked about in classes past is a lot of students did every ability learning disabilities, and one of the things that they really developed are survival strategies, and as the students that have been in class all semester now, they're trying to bring in videos that can possibly start to help illustrate some of these pieces. And in a second, I'm going to show you a video about specific learning disabilities. And what this video is it's about a 6-minute long video, and it was actually a student project that was done by a student with a specific learning disability. He actually narrates it, and his friend acts it out. And I think that if you listen to the dialogue, we will talk about what specific learning disabilities are and what it entails, and we can talk about auditory difficulties, visual difficulties. We've watched Fat City clips earlier in the semester, but sometimes hearing from the students really can add a depth of knowledge that you can't get, and that's why we like to use video in these cases. So we're going to cut to this clip. It's about 6 minutes, and I'll see you in 6 minutes.
When I wake up, knowing that my diagnosis of having learning disabilities, I feel troubled. My mother always told me, be patient and take it step by step. My school seems just lost. They want my learning to be grasped into the best standards. The materials I need to acquire, the classes I need to graduate, all come too fast at me. I will learn slower than most people. My mind sometimes goes on my hands and sometimes. I can't figure out where the little pieces are in order to fail and succeed. Although it does not stop me from going to things I would like, maybe someday, my learning disability seems to disappear. My reflection stresses is one of the biggest complications. Showing the school every day has motivated me to feel I can succeed. It may take longer for me to comprehend how to use study hall programs, but I can succeed. I need to be patient and ready to accomplish.
And, you know, while it may come across as over the top, it's interesting to be able to hear what goes on inside of this, or if it's the doctors were sharing us before we went in with, you know, isolation, what was the take on the thing?
Well, I think, first of all, it speaks to the fact that for a lot of our students with special needs, schools do not have a place for them. It's why our students have significantly higher rates of dropout than new students who don't have special needs. So school's always more challenging. It's also important to remember that these are the students who are probably working twice as hard. School's twice as hard as them. Everything takes longer. Oftentimes, not just generally speaking, for a lot of our students, things take longer, they're working twice as hard. And then there's also use of social isolation. I think this video is a good example of that, that for a lot of our students, they realize their the difference or their disability impacts their social skills, and so school is a difficult place for them to navigate. Things that we know automatically are something that a student has to learn, whether or not it's a social curriculum, what's cool and what's not cool, whether or not it's what the teacher expectations are, that there are a lot of implicit messages that are sent every day, and we, kids who are typically developing makeup on them like that, the kids who have disabilities, they need to be explicitly described to them.
I don't know if I already mentioned it, perhaps this or you, I don't know if you know, but do you know how many or what percentage or what about number of kids have some sort of learning? It's the big umbrella of kids with special needs, but if you're going to teach in a class of 40 kids, what might be the likelihood that there's...
Well, we would just expect on a 10% of any given school population would have a disability. That it's not very frequently occurring. And that's why earlier I said that we can have some over-identification or disproportionality within each of the categories. So I can't give you an exact figure because you could, for example, have a student who has a specific learning disability and never even be referred to receive special education services because he or she has been successful in their academic setting. They've always had teachers that work with them. They've always had teachers who take an effort. They've had teachers who differentiate instruction so that they have an existing disability, but it's never ever impacted their academic achievements. So they were never ever referred for special ed services.
Speaking about referring for special ed services, the Margaret has a question about do private schools have access to special education for public schools? Or is there any requirement for a private school to provide?
Yes, that's an excellent question. So, when IDEA was reauthorized in 2004, the provision to provide services or consultative services to the private schools was increased. So, all students who attend, it's the public school that has the obligation to provide free appropriate public education. And it really is the home school, except for in the case, without getting too deep nuance, so let's say that you're the parent of a student in a private school, and you believe that your child may have a disability. Maybe you think they have a specific learning disability. It is your right to go to a public school, and in this case, you would go to the public school that's within the same district that the private school is in, and you would request an evaluation. That public school has an obligation to evaluate your child for special needs.
Even if you go to a private school?
Even if you go to a private school.
But that's your home school.
Well, that's the nuance that I didn't want to get into because it's hard to get into the real specifics, but basically here's how it goes. But I'm interested to you as an example. So you suspect that one of your children has a specific learning disability, and you live in a Torrance, but your student makes a drive here to Carson. You have your child in a private school in Carson. You will go to the public school in Carson and say, I would like to request an evaluation of my child. The school in Carson would evaluate your child. They would have a full evaluation and no charge. And then when an IEP meeting was held, it would be the school that your child would attend in Torrance that would say, here is the offer of faith for the broken public education that we can provide to your student. Your child, if your child needs to attend his or her home school. Now, sometimes, and in lots of cases, there is collaboration between the private and the public sector, and maybe it's a special language, maybe it is just a meeting time where the special education teacher consults with the private school, but most often it's the public school that provides the offer of faith, and most often it occurs at that public school setting, at the student's home school.
One of the other pieces that always comes up is the issue of labeling. I know that now I have actually done that private schools could go to the local public school, the school that's close to them, and request testing. But what about the factor of labeling? And Teresa Partridge actually is asked, the person asking this, which is, what are the benefits of labeling kids? I know that some of the benefits of labeling kids, if you label a child appropriately, then what you end up being able to do is you can now target strategies to help them. But obviously, the labeling on the other side of this, kids can be mean. Some teachers, not all teachers, but obviously some teachers out there, have different levels of expectations, have different stereotypical beliefs that affect the quality of instruction that they're giving them.
There's two sides. Okay. So, just from a strictly legal aspect, the categorization or the category of disability is directly tied to funding. So, you actually need to meet the requirements. Now, I can take two different sides of whether or not labeling is good. For some students, when you say you have a specific learning disability, again, when I taught at a middle school setting and I had conferences and I reviewed IEPs with my students, and I said, you have a specific learning disability, and this is what this means. They were like, I'm not stupid. On the other side, you're right, it can change expectations. A student can have a negative response to that. So there is no right or wrong answer. For some students, you need to have a label to receive services. I'll give you an example, though. For some labels, the consequences are not only immediate. If you had a student who had a label of emotional disturbance, and that is placed into that student's care file, that label carries with them. So let's say it is a senior who's labeled as having an emotional disturbance, and maybe they want to be a peace officer, maybe they want to join the military, maybe they want to join the FBI, and there's a request for those records. It is there in those records stating that this child was categorized as having an emotional disturbance.
But are there provisions that you know of in this police officer or law enforcement if you have a label like that, you can't do your work? I don't know.
Yeah, maybe, yes. Yes. Yes.
That brings up part of the question, which we're going to get to a little later.
Oh, I was going to give another example of a label might be beneficial. It's more political. It's hard to imagine, but until recently, we executed individuals who, even though they had the label of mental retardation or cognitive intellectual disabilities, now we no longer execute individuals who have that label. So that may be within the judicial system, if you are found guilty. So the labeling sometimes.
Okay, with regard to the, let's say Teresa Labus has a question here that says, how far can a school go if parents refuse special education services? Let's say, to use your example earlier, that I think, that you think, as a teacher, that my child has a learning disability. And since I don't know much about the special education world, I say that's impossible. Not my kid, because I know that a lot of parents do that. Women are using them, bad parents, they don't understand. Can I refuse service as a parent?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I to think about it. Not only can you can refuse services, you can also homeschool. Now, it's not only that you can refuse services. I mean, the question was how far can the school district go? Well, school district can also take their due process. It's really not the best, and it's really not the best solution. You always want to work with the parent to meet the student's needs. But the bottom line is that a parent can refuse services for their child. The better, and actually where I have seen it, is when in an IEP, and there's a label, maybe the IEP team, or maybe the school psychologist feels that a student should be labeled as having a cognitive and intellectual disability, or as the student's label underneath the law as having mental retardation. And a parent might say, I don't want that label given to my child. Does that mean that we can't provide services? Not necessarily. We can still provide services. And maybe we determine that it's not important what the label is. So I always think that the best route is to work with parents. And parents, for whatever reason, if they don't feel that their child needs special services, is there right?
Well, she's watching the videos that we brought. It was a video walking dyslexia. And it's kind of one of those things about when I talk with parents of students with special needs. One of the things that they see are our parents and kids are identified as disabled. I didn't understand what they felt, what they went through, and I thought that part of it was one bad parenting rather than this is something, this is something your child didn't do intentionally. Do you find that to be another big reason?
Well, I can tell you that we used to tell mothers back in the 60s who had children who had the symptoms that we now identify as autistic. We actually used to say that it was mom's parenting style. And actually, there was a term that was widely used, it was called the movie trainer mom. So mothers who would bring their children to the doctor, or babies usually to an MD, and the MD would say, yeah, you were a cold parent. Your child is reacting and is withdrawn because of your parenting style. So actually, there have been lots of instances where we have blamed the parent. And remember, too, that an environment, a poor environment, can lead to disabilities. We know that.
Oh, how so?
So, we can take...
Financially poor, emotionally poor.
Yes, okay. So let me give you the biggest extreme. We have children who have been severely neglected, maybe isolated. You hear the cases of kids who were locked away from when they were very young, never had any social interaction, never had any parent interaction, and they never ever developed language. And maybe they're discovered when they're 20. I think we just had a case in California not too recently where it was a woman, and she wasn't discovered until she was in her late teens. It is likely that her cognitive development, that she missed critical periods. It's also likely that her speech and language will never ever improve. I mean, it will improve, but it will never ever be commensurate with her age or chronologically appropriate because the environment was lacking in stimulation, because of the physical and the emotional abuse and the neglect. So when we say that environment can actually cause disabilities, that's what we mean specifically.
Interesting. One of the things that I wanted to make sure we got to before the break was I was referencing a moment ago, which is what must it be like to have a disability? And while we try to show you that in Fat City, so for those of you that want to see that, you can go back to the archive and take a look at that. I did find it quick, and it's an interesting piece that shows some of the basic demonstrations of dyslexia and some of the ways that it was articulated in terms of how it feels. And while it is, you know, entertaining because it has a musical accompaniment, if you look at the pieces that describe what it is, I think that this may give some additional insight for some of the two methods or watch any more dyslexia, so take a look at this.
Which is now approaching 600, and our university has been promoted to so that others who are in years to come have the opportunity to have a wonderful experience. The staff, the faculty, and this, the students who are here. Thank you for all of you.
Welcome to the University Art Gallery. My name is Kathy Slovakovi, and I'm director of the Art Gallery, and we'd like to welcome you to our upcoming New Citizen Events. Coming up from November 12th through December 10th of 2009 is Fugitive Dimensions, T.U. Ashcroft, and Russell McMillan. It is an exhibition featuring 35 works of art by two contemporary artists from Los Angeles who work with figure in two and three dimensions. On display will be artists T.U. Ashcroft's large-scale mixed-media drawings of nudes and Russell McMillan's fantastic ceramic figures, including power, culture, and icon. His torsos are covered in armor and resting corsets and made of ceramic and mixed-media.
Thank you so much, and we look forward to seeing you at our exhibition this evening as a campus character.
Your life. Increase your learning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree will be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. By name, call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
Teatro Dominguez is a multiple theater company here in Los Angeles Hills, and the program is designed to do play readings, workshops, and folk tale tours to local elementary schools. We do that every year. The idea is
part of the seventh grade class. So what the task does for this kind of education is theater that focuses on social issues and has more of a direct purpose for society.
Attention businesses in the South Bay of Los Angeles. The South Bay Resource Network and the South Bay Lost Stars are here to help you grow.
I found out about the Lost Stars that represent in my store and presented the services that they provide.
The agency's involved in over 4,000 applicants. We had 125 jobs, and Lost Stars really helped us find the true gems in the color of all
on the business side, Lost Stars provides knowledge training, provides the resources for contacts. Also provides a resource for training to be able to take some of their functions training pieces so we do the classes and areas of the
data. Yeah, this is a great experience. There is a desktop, but always helpful in understanding
the services design and the TCC. The South Bay Resource Network is here for you. Call 317-7799 or visit our website at southbayresource.net.
The Lone Star is a resource for business in South Bay.
This is my university.
Nice paper.
Welcome back. I hope you've had a nice break. And as we come back to the last 45 minutes of class, we are sitting here with Kate Esposito. And what I really wanted to come out of the gates here is just as we normally do, just give you a quick recap. We spent the first half of class talking about defining special education. We talked about people first language. We talked about the most frequently referred disabilities. We talked about syncrotic disabilities. We talked a little bit about speech and language. We talked about mild and moderate disabilities and moderate and severe disabilities. But the one piece that did come out was that autism seems to be very highly diagnosed. In fact, there's a whole bunch of stuff out in the media, as many of you probably know about. You know, is autism curable? What is it? Why do so many kids have it? It seems like this is like the disability that's in vogue almost now. And a lot of people, they don't really know what it is. And so what I thought we would come out of the gates with here is, I went online and tried to find the beautifully rubbing your fingers in the walk, and now you see the yellow pages. Now you just go to YouTube or Google, and you can find the world with your hands. But when I find a video that was an interview with an autism expert that goes through 5 minutes, so it's going to give you another piece of this. But I'm going to come back and debrief that a little bit, and I'm going to share with you a story from when I was teaching at Santa Monica College about a student with Asperger's. So what I'm hoping that you get here out of the next 12 minutes or so is you can hear an interview with an autism expert, and then we'll try to help separate the difference between what autism is and what Asperger's is. And then we're going to come through and talk about identification issues, inclusion, what can teachers do, and then the big question I see all over the text board about how do I engage parents, how do I talk to parents without infuriating them and making them feel like they're bad parents. So what I'm just going to turn you over to a video here. It's literally just about 5 minutes long, and I think enjoyed it. It's very informative, and I will see you in class.
If you have to get diagnosed in early, intervention is the key. Hello again, and thanks for joining us. I'm Carla Chevalier from watching Comcast Newsmakers. In the studio with me this hour is Jean Ruttenberg. She is the Executive Director for the Center for Autism. And today we're talking about Autism Awareness Month. Thanks for joining us today, Jean. And of course, April being Autism Awareness Month. Tell us, what is autism?
Okay, autism is, by definition, a neurological disorder that affects the function of the brain. It affects the developmental areas of development, such as the development of language, skills that we might expect a child to do early on, such as watch mommy, so eye contact, and things like that. They're delayed, or sometimes not there. So that autism is described mainly by three core components that are along with core deficits. One is the communication area. So the ability to communicate with another person, the ability to develop language, developmentally appropriate language, those are the areas that you see off. Social interaction is a key. That's the ability to interact with another child, with mommy and daddy, in a way that there's enjoyment, there's relationship, there's fun.
Yeah.
And that's one of the things that parents see, that there's not that joyful. Fun part of the intimacy of their interactions with their child. And an area we call restrictive behavior, and that's about sort of obsessiveness with one particular thing.
Like an object
or object, or maybe a particular interest. Traits is a big thing. I know a lot of young people and adults who still have a great fascination with traits. But it could be as simple as a toy, it has wheels, and what they like is not the function of the toy or the truck, but the fact that the wheels go round and round. So those are the three key areas, the things that we look for in a child, though, in terms of interacting, is from here to look at the outcome, then we look at children, they want to be alone versus playing with their children. We look at things like their ability to deal with the multiple environments, like they're not crying every time they go into a new place, the ability to make a change. You know, your child is full of a lot of changes, the ability to not melt down when that change occurs. These are kids who you might say like to tweak.
And then you talk about that spectrum.
Yes, you know,
so many degrees.
One of the things that we use in the field is that you've seen one autistic child or person, you've seen one autistic child or person, and that's because the diversity is there. It's inherent in the diagnostic category. They're all different.
These oldest, if you will, she was significant role that you're still playing within the community.
When the oldest player in the country specializing in autism assessments, 55, 50, we provide a diagnostic service, we provide a program, a day program for children ages 1 to 5, 5 days a week, and we have 50 children in that program. We also do a social competency program, which runs 4 nights a week. We do consultation and training for school districts, special providers, counties. So we really provide a very comprehensive program.
Right, and helping parents, because I think there's a period where parents just have that denial, and they need to overcome.
Well, they have denial.
Yeah. Yes.
What do I do? Years ago, there were about 4 things. You can find out autism, now there's 4,000. Mm-hmm. So the parents are confined with a new dilemma, which is, how do I choose? How do I know it's okay? How do I make that choice in terms of my child? We have a, I didn't mention it, but we have a parent program that's totally wrapped around every program we do. So the parent component is as important to us as the child component of these children and families.
Of course, yes.
And we help the parents, we help the child.
Of course, that helps society in understanding the disorder. Thanks so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
Information. This hour's newsmaker has been Jean Ruttenberg.
So,
I'm going to
give you some information about what autism is, and hopefully some website, another website for you that are interested in trying to learn a little bit more about autism. It's a website called autismspeaks.org, and if you just Google Autism Speaks, there's a lot of different resources out there. In fact, our first listening was one that was really encouraging me to go explore that website, so please give that a look. I'm going to, before going to that video, but I wanted to give you a little bit of information. information about what autism is, and then share with you a story about SMC, and then lead you into this next very briefing, which is just about 3 weeks long. Fundamentally, when I was teaching at Santa Monica College, I taught a student success course, which was the University 101 course here, and I had one student that seemed very socially removed, overly focused on tasks, and in class, he would raise his hand, and I would call on him, and then he would almost just zone out for a minute or two, and it was a real awkward experience where I didn't know what he was doing, and I didn't know if he was serious or if something was happening, and then he would formulate his question, he would share it, and then he would always have questions during the course of the semester, and every time he would raise his hand, part of me would say, no. And you feel tension in the room because nobody really knew what was happening. Anyway, he came to me one day, probably about 11 weeks into the semester, it was almost over. And he said, I just want to let you know that I have this condition called Asperger's syndrome. But at the time, I never heard this before. I never heard the word. I said, what is Asperger's syndrome? Now, the way I'm going to share the story with you is that Asperger's syndrome is a high-functioning autism, as Dr. Simpson shared with us earlier. And one of the things that that I learned about identifying Asperger's and overly fixating on certain pieces was that I said, what is Asperger's? And he didn't answer. He turned and he walked away, and I thought, I said, okay, great, now here's something that you need, something that's called syndrome. And I asked him what it is, and they walked away from me, so I figured I insulted him, but lo and behold, in my office the next morning, 8:30 in the morning, he shows up with no less than 5 books and about 15 research articles on Asperger's syndrome. And I said, what is this? And he says, just read this, and it should make sense. And so fundamentally, if you had things to add here, it was interesting because it was like, what I learned was that they're socially, almost totally socially isolated, where he ended up getting into, I want to say it was Reed College in Oregon, where they ended up putting him on a full scholarship, where he couldn't go until he learned how to live on his own. But this guy, when he turned in a paper, literally to this day, named the best paper I've ever read.
Well, that is, as the video even pointed out, that is the defining characteristic, is language. And then it's also the inability for many of our students to read social skills. So that, let's take that student who had Asperger's, who's very high functioning. In a K-12 setting, the only area that may have been notable to other teachers would have been his or her social skills. Now, are there interventions that we provide for that student? There may be a social skills group that student would go to, because ultimately the outcome that we're looking for in any K-12 setting is that individuals going to be able to be a productive member of society and reach their full potential, whatever that is. So that student, we're not going to get any academic support, but that student may have needed some social support, because it is incumbent upon all of us as teachers to ensure that our students have a safe learning environment. If that student is being teased when he or she goes to school, then we have to protect that student as a teacher. So, and also, it's important to note, you had never heard about Asperger's, and here you are working with the student. Now, you were working with an adult student. If you were able to articulate and to advocate for yourself, you may have a third grade student who doesn't know why school's so difficult, doesn't know why he or she, and cannot express, or more importantly, can't advocate. And what you may take as being very rude and defiant. And maybe the student's not trying to be defiant. We often hear, and I think we had an email earlier, well, they just need tough love, or they just need this. We have to remember that students don't come to school to make our life as teachers miserable. They actually want to come and have a good day. But your student was able to advocate for himself and had a good understanding of what his disability is. So I see that also as being a responsibility that we have, whether we're general education teachers or special education teachers, are that we have to inform our students and enable them to be advocates.
And so with that, to that point about being an advocate, I want to share with you a video that yet again I got on YouTube that's about 3 minutes long. And the reason why I want to share this with you is simple, is that for those of you that find that in every session that we talk about special education, it's one of the big gaps in general education schools everywhere.
Asian pathological well-meaning force called mainstream, and that was the entire piece of specification. Those who are interested, I always use them as soon as they say, you know, I want to come to you special ed, this is fantastic. All you do is email me or email a doctor, and we'll get you some email information later. But what I want to share with you is about a 3-minute-long video that will, I believe that the launch date on PBS is going to be January 10th. And you'll be able to see the full program, and I think you're going to get a taste of what I was trying to share with you, but now you can put your own teeth into it. So we're going to watch the video here on Asperger's and sort of a table that things are enjoying.
I have trouble reading people's emotions. Emotions like smile, crying, anger. There's certain things that people do with their eyes, their nose, their mouth, their hands, their everything. You just don't see them. 29-year-old Jason Ross has Asperger's, a neurological disorder that appears in the ability to read other people's emotions, which makes relationships extremely difficult.
Is he looking for their dad?
Since I'm Asperger's, I don't know if people like me or people don't like me. Why is he so frustrated?
I felt that something's not quite right with Jason. Today, I brought him home from the hospital. His responses were not as quick as they should have been.
As Jason grew up, the nature of his problem increased in the care. He was bright, healthy, but just couldn't connect with other people.
And so he walked away with him. He was thrilled that he had had someone come off and play with him. The only thing is, he really didn't want to hit you back with him.
Where is Jason? I'm 16 years old.
Shut up. I couldn't take him well. Everyone else was playing out of disc golf. I wanted to do my own thing.
I think Jason was one of the loneliest people I ever met. He didn't have to relate to people on any level.
We learn to relate to people. Our parents and families have to with us. But other people don't. As it turns out, family relationships are, in some sense, they're just friends for what comes next. As children, our parents and siblings are the whole world to us, but as we grow, the world expands to include friends. From childhood, as an adolescent, Facebook is immediately into a few thousand by the time you're done. Everyone knows that friends are good for us, but everyone knows it doesn't help. Without friendships, people suffer in ways that science doesn't even understand.
When I look at all these people, one of the things I notice is very few of them are interacting with each other. They're just in the same place at the same time. Do you see a lot of loneliness when you look out on the scene like us?
I see a lot of isolation.
Is it a naturally lonely as well?
Absolutely. So John can see most studies how our biology is affected by our social relationships. He's focused on much as more living impact of our loneliness.
Loneliness is associated with a variety of mental and physical disorders. Heart disease, diabetes, dementias, accidents, suicides, and all that range. So you're at risk as much from being lonely as you are from smoking.
It sounds hard to believe, but the answer is yes, it's bad for people's health.
So there's your teaser about turning on PBS. I think you go to PBS.com, starts around January 10th. I don't know the name of it, but I can't wait to watch it. It really starts to give you a look at this. I know we have a caller. I'm going to get to the caller in a second. But one of the things that you were talking to me about was when we were watching that, which is sort of what Jeremy said, we need to make sure that we talk about the invisible disability.
Yeah, I think it's important for us as good citizens and as teachers just to know that we often an invisible disability. Oftentimes, kids who have disabilities, they don't look any different than students who don't have disabilities. The student having Asperger's development and the student being able to matter, there's no physical characteristics that bring to us as that the student has a disability. It's very easy to be patient with somebody who we know right away has a disability. Maybe they have a guide dog, or maybe they use a cane. So, maybe they have physical characteristics that they have Down syndrome. So, it's important for us to know that, and I think particularly with our students who have ADD or our students who have specific learning disabilities, just to always keep that in mind. One, that they're just, that most of them are just students, and that as the educator we have to be a bigger, better person, and that also means to be patient. But it also means that we don't have to be intimidated, and we don't hold that against our students.
Let's see who's been so patient on hold.
Yes.
And we have Yandira calling from Hawthorne. Yandira, what's up?
Actually, you know, I have a question in regards to ADD. My son is in the 8th grade, and ever since I can remember, he's had a difficult time with math. And at this time, he's failing math, but I recently had a meeting with a teacher, and I just felt like she wasn't aware that he had ADD, even though there's an IEP and he has accommodations for it. What can I do to help him? I mean, I don't know if he's getting his needs met in the classroom by the teacher, if she's, you know, trying to help him. So what kind of suggestions can you give me to help him?
So you said something very interesting. You said that your student has a current, your son has a current IEP, and you went to meet with the general education teacher where the student's included in her classroom?
So I went to talk to the teacher because I wanted to know why was he failing. I mean, what if she could give me any insight as to how to help him.
Mm-hmm.
And when I mentioned something about it, and I don't know if she just didn't know, or she just didn't remember at that time, but I got that feeling like she wasn't aware that he had ADD, even though, he has an IEP, and it states that he should have certain accommodations in the classroom. And so, my thing is, I'm not sure if he's getting his needs met in the classroom by the teacher. I mean, if she notices maybe that he's not paying attention, if she tries to encourage him, I don't know if she tries to help him, if she sees that he's confused and doesn't get what needs to be learning.
Okay, there's one thing. What strikes me the most is, it is your right as a parent to intervene at IEP team. If you don't feel that the IEP is serving your student's needs, then you can reconvene the IEP team. And the individuals that would be present at that IEP team would be the general education teacher, the administrator, yourself, the special education teacher, and your son, if that's appropriate. And at that time, you can say, these are the accommodations that my son is entitled to, and have they been implemented? If they've been implemented and they're not effective, then you need to modify that IEP and ask for additional supports. You actually, and I think this is important for all general education teachers to know, that general education teachers are accountable and should be held accountable to implement all of the accommodations and modifications as specified. If a student is failing, and if your son is failing, and if he is in fact attending school regularly, if he is in fact doing everything that you feel that he needs to be doing, and you just feel that it's because his needs haven't been met, then you need to revisit that. And even if for some reason your son is afraid to go to school or whatever, that's still a good reason to reconvene the IEP.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you for calling. At this point, some of the things I wanted to tap into to your expertise on. Really, one of the big reasons that always comes up has to do with identification issues. What should teachers do
deliver any warning, why he didn't warn something like this. But what should teachers be looking for? What are the implication pieces?
I always think that the biggest piece is that the student is really putting forth a lot of effort and is just not getting success. That's one. Or on the spectrum, the other spectrum is that the student has just given completely they haven't had success. Other things are like with regard to a specific grade disability, they may maintain consistent performance. Maybe one day retain all of the math facts and can tell you what they are, but the next day he or she isn't able to do that. Or maybe they're high and low areas of achievement. Your student does really, really well in reading and doesn't do very well in math, or vice versa. Those would be very common ones. Another one might be that the student is anxious. Maybe it is that the student is physically active. He or she isn't able to stay seated for long periods of time. He or she isn't able to focus. Or maybe they are focusing, but they're not focusing on the right aspect of the lesson. Whenever, I think just the bottom line is that whenever you have a student in your classroom not achieving academically or not meeting with success, it's a good time to call a team together and to look at a problem-solving approach. What in the environment is working for the student, what isn't working for the student. I think it's always important to look at what the environment is it use that instead of saying, well, then it's just the student's fault, the student doesn't want to learn. Well, we need to take a step back as educators and really look at what the environment is and what in the environment is preventing him or her from learning.
Well, and another part of the thing of this is that when we talk about teachers getting together and talking, one of the things that we used to talk about all the time were student study teams or SSTs, and now we're moving into this world of response to intervention or RTI, where, you know, it's like this three-tiered or four-tiered pyramid where the base is just supposed to be, you know, good, effective, something that meets the needs of all the kids, which of course seems somewhat like an oxymoron because in a lot of the classes that I go, we're not seeing good, effective teaching. What should, and again, we're on really limited time, and I want to give everybody as many questions as we can, but in terms of response to intervention, what might be some of the pieces that teachers that are in teacher credential programs, like the people watching this, need to know aside from document what you're seeing, come to a group ready to collaborate? What's some of the other pieces that they need to think of?
I think that most important in our time is documenting progress or the performance of a student and really quantifying it. So here's where the student's performing relative to his or her peers. Here's an intervention that I'm going to give. I'm going to go back and measure the student's performance, whether it be like, let's say it's a weekly probe or a monthly reading probe. And after a month, you've implemented a program or you've implemented an intervention, you have a baseline of performance. You go back and measure it in a month. Relative to the student's peers or to that student relative to his or her peers, he's not achieving commensurate with the other students. So then you might say, well, you know what, let's do a more intensive intervention. And then again, you go back and you measure, is this an effective intervention for the student? When you have really systematically, consistently, and with fidelity implemented an intervention program and it is not effective, then I think it's time as a team to really come together again and say, what haven't we considered? Let's think outside the box.
I remember you and I gave a presentation about RTI and about the, I remember when we talked about the fidelity of implementation of the program, like, there was almost a chuckle in the room because everybody knows that the elephant in the room, which is you have to see it through and really look at assessment. Is the behavior changing and document progress, which is enormous for those of you watching. We start looking at what RTI is, and then you can go and just Google response to intervention, and you'll find maybe.
And in California, it's RTI squared because it is response to intervention and looking at effective instruction, so it is fidelity.
Which is why when you start getting into your methods course, you really need to pay specific attention. Which, so that's RTI, at least the next question, which is okay. What can a teacher do, and what is a teacher supposed to do? I mean, so what's the general education teacher
mandated to do?
So, well, the first thing is that I think I read a question earlier, or even the mother who just called in said that she didn't think that her son's teacher was aware that he had an IEP. Every general ed teacher is responsible to implement an IEP day one. So, yes, that special student who has an IEP is assigned to a case manager. That case manager needs to inform the general education teachers that this student has an IEP. They should give that teacher a summary of his or her performance. Let them know what the strengths and weaknesses are, because all students have strengths and weaknesses. And we really want to play it to every student's strength. And then, regardless of whether you feel as a general ed teacher that student's properly diagnosed, you might say, oh, I don't believe for a minute that student has a specific learning disability, he's just lazy. That's not your place as a general ed teacher. You have an IEP, and the team has agreed that the student is entitled to these services, and it's your responsibility to implement them. Now, if you really don't feel that IEP is accurate, or you don't feel that the IEP has provided adequate accommodations or modifications, then the general education teacher can request an IEP meeting or team be reconvened. But it's never an individual decision. It's placed by the student with specific learning disabilities, the accommodations and modifications that are provided to that, and the services that are provided is always a team decision. It's not just one person.
Is it called, and this is a lot of work I've done in schools, which is it is a cultural phenomenon in schools where schools have to be willing and understand and able that they have to come together and talk about this and buy into the change process. Speaking of that, we are paying through a few student questions here. Shannon's got a perfect one that says, I understand why we must advocate for all disabled students. However, where do we draw the line between advocating for them and maintaining a standard for acceptable behavior? I have a special ed student who is constantly disrupting my class, and it sometimes makes it very difficult to maintain a positive classroom environment. I think the thing I would add or ask you in that regard is, there's the use of the word advocating in there, because when you standards, when a student's not behaving, and you're meeting the needs of the students in terms of accommodations, is the role to set a student, for example, if you have a consequence system, if you have a rules and consequences, child's not following through with what they need to do, where do you go online? Here's the classroom teachers.
Well, there's a couple of pieces. I think that's a common, it's a common perception. I'm not going to say that it's always an accurate perception. My experience in working with students who have special needs is that when they're not able to access the general education curriculum, it's not enough just to have a student physically included in a general education classroom. The work actually has to be modified to meet their needs. They have to be able to access it. Then you may have some students who act up, and I would say that that's because the instruction and the curriculum is not suited to that student. That's one aspect. Now, let me give you another kind of devil's advocate. Sometimes the student's disability actually has a behavioral component to it. And in that case, then that student should have what's called a positive behavior support plan. The general education teacher can and should request that they look into having a positive behavior support plan. Because maybe you know what, you really like Johnny, who's included in your third grade class. And Johnny consistently comes to school with things that are erased. And he's erased them so much that now there's holes in it, and it's just not the type of work you accept. And you really don't feel that you should accept that, because every other student has to type up their work, and all of the work has to be submitted. And maybe it turns out that that's part of Johnny's disability, is that he obsessively erases. He doesn't have good dimension. So maybe the IEP team has decided that a reasonable accommodation is that he will accept any work that he submits. And in that case, you can need a positive behavior support plan. And maybe it's that he is so obsessive about doing imperfect work that he does the work, and then when he gets to school, he doesn't turn it in because he doesn't feel that it's good enough. And that's part of his disability.
strategy to change that behavior and make an accommodation.
Now, I think the piece that a lot of the general teachers don't understand is that accommodation is not a hookup.
It's not a special.
The child is considered a child with low sight. They have no visual problems. So you're letting the offspring down with that. So now you're saying that everybody else can type something up and turn it in. And I know this kid with special needs can get a keyboard and can use this. And actually, just accept it. I'm not going to do that.
But not every student. That student has a disability. And again, as a general education teacher, I would put that back onto you. And I would say, did you attend that IEP meeting to have a clear understanding of what the student's disability is? Because it's not an arbitrary decision that's been made that this student gets this accommodation. It has been a team decision, and it should be well thought out. And I think the best case scenario is that teachers come together and say, this is what's going to enable this student to be this. Let's say that Sarah takes, I don't know, she takes three times as long to complete work in class. And your sense is, it's time test, but I need her to get the test done on time. And part of that is that she needs to be able to meet it in that time frame. And maybe as a team, you say, but she's not going to be able to meet the requirement. Let's reduce her work in half so that she can demonstrate that she's met this and that she understands that. And that would be best case scenario where you say, I know she knows this, she can't do it in the time frame, so let's give her a
decision. Okay, but as Michelle Morrison says, the question she does say that, what about the one that's destructive? It interferes with my ability to reach all the students. So she says, I don't think the students should be isolated because they might have challenges. We all have challenges. But what if disruptive behavior is making it difficult for the rest of the class? Or if you've got the one you got trying, who can't? You know, sits still, or he can't behave, or he's just not so well fast. But now he's interfering with other kids that don't have a disability, but might find it entertaining.
Well, I think first of all, it's good to look at the IEP team, or look at the student studies and say, here's the interventions that I've tried with Johnny. Because I don't think we only put it on Johnny. Well, Johnny just doesn't want to behave well in this classroom. But there might be something in the environment that is leading to his misbehavior. You know, it sounds right. But something as simple as giving Johnny two desks, so when he starts getting agitated, he can get up and move to a separate desk, and that will calm him down. Maybe he taps his feet all the time, which is what I hear teachers say all the time. Oh, he's always tapping his head, it's disturbing everybody. Well, maybe you give him a rubber pencil to tap, and then he's not disturbing everybody. So I don't think we only put it on that student, that we look at really what's going on in the environment as well.
Yeah, a lot of it also is having it moved to the teachers taking accountability for what they're doing to help modify the environment as well. The question I want to make sure that we get to, and I'm trying to get through a lot of these questions, maybe something you won't get to, but I'm going to do it for this one, which is one of the big challenges that I work on with teachers all the time is how do you sit down and tell a parent that you think their child has a special need? I would preface this with, as my students know, I've talked about the fact that I have two adolescent kids at home, and I think that my 13-year-old is extraordinarily bright, but she is wonderful. I remember her my very first parent conference. I've been teaching for over a year, so also I didn't know about this. I went to the parent conference, and the parent conference meant something like, well, you know, your daughter is wonderful, and she's so considerate, and she does great work, and she's an artist, and she loves her letters and her numbers. You know, if she won't have you, you just keep up her, but if you come, you just a little cleaner. I'm like, oh my God, like, you're stressing horrible off. And I was like, well, that was when people would have to sit down, and I know this, and I know what this is like, but, you know, as a parent, I know that it's like somebody's putting a hole in your chest. You know, in the Erica show, actually, there's a question that says, what's good with letting a parent know that your child might have one of those things without offending or angering the parent? What might be a couple of strategies that you can suggest to some of the students out there? Because it's going to confront every single one of them.
Well, there's actually a lot of research into this area. And I think the approach to this, I'm going to approach this from a couple of different perspectives. First of all, depending upon the severity of the disability, the parent is already going to know. Say it was diagnosed at birth. Sometimes it's only diagnosed in an academic setting because it's the only time that the disability impacts performance. Or oftentimes you'd be surprised if the parent is like, I know, and now that you say this, and now I have a label to this, and now I understand what this disability is. So that's one thing. I would say that in attending a lot of IEPs and really working with parents, is that IEPs often go something like this. Everybody sits down. And everybody introduces themselves. I'm Dr. Miller. I'm the school psychologist. I'm Mrs. Smith. I'm the nurse. And everybody has these written reports. And they read from these written reports in this very academic language. And the very last sentence of the report says that we believe that the child has a specific learning disability. And everybody goes around the room and reads through the written report and then says, to the parent, well, what do you think of this? Well, they don't know what to say because everybody's already said everything. It would be much more effective if we ask parents, well, what do you see at home? And does the disability impact? Because don't forget, you can have a student who doesn't read or write very well in an academic setting, but at home translates for mom and dad all the time. Fixes the car, fixes the TV, can get online. And so the student has all of these strengths that we see in the home environment, but then when they go to school, they're just not meeting success. So we always have to make sure that depending upon the disability that it's manifested and how the disability is manifested. So if it's a specific learning disability, it might only impact educational performance. If it is something more severe, like a cognitive and intellectual disability, well, you would expect that the parents would see it at home and that we would see it in an educational setting. So it's always important to give parents the input.
Yeah, that was a great question by Eric. It's interesting that you have lots of different parent conferences, and it's always the tough piece to have a conversation about. But anyway, there were a couple of other questions that I wanted to get at, and there is right there with Alita LaJuga. Says, what types of ramifications are there for parents who don't want to get their children tested for a disability, even though it's clear that the child has some form of mental disability and they be charged with neglect? I think that they can't be charged with neglect.
Well, in the school, just like the parents have due process, the school has due process. I have never, ever seen a school district go after a parent for that because a parent can refuse services.
And remember that piece as you're listening or watching, I should say, is that a parent can refuse services if the parent is refusing services. That's not by definition. One other question I wanted to jump into, because we're starting to come up on the clock, is that we talked about this question from Teresa earlier when one of the, during the break, actually, we saw it about cover shields. Teresa Lema says, I've heard that color shields over pages is one of the strategies to help students better focus on their reading. Is this one strategy? And so what color would help students most? But can you just explain what an overlay is to the students and then address them?
So there's different types of overlay. It's generally speaking, it's thought that overlays maybe reduce the glare, or sometimes in fluorescent lights there's kind of a flicker, and sometimes that can be really troublesome to students. So it's thought that depending upon the type of overlay that you use it to reduce that interference with the environment, I would say that I don't know how much empirical data exists to really support their effectiveness or their efficacy, but if they work for a student, then you can try different colors. I actually, if it works for a student, then it works. That's great. You're going to have lots of tricks in your bag whenever you're working with kids who have disabilities, but with all students. So there is no one size fits all. It's lots of different tools and lots of different strategies, and that's the hard part about being an effective teacher is being able to have multiple strategies to intervene.
speaking of teachers, whether it's Alberto Mejia has a question about, you know, parents can ask for a change. Teachers can also ask for re-giving them IEP. If IEP goals are being demonstrated as being met, you can ask for IEPs, because IEPs, if I, unless it's changed, have to be revisited. IEP goals have to be revisited annually.
Yes, so IEPs need to be held triannually, and they need to be held annually, at least annually. So you can actually hold an IEP more than once a year. And you can request a reevaluation at any time. The school doesn't have to do reevaluation just because you request it, but you can request an evaluation. The annual IEPs are just looking at progress towards those annual goals and what interventions have been made.
Well, what if the goal is way off base, like, for example, Donna DeFanzo, who's been a consistent caller and texter, says, you know, what if the IEP, what if the goal is too extreme, says that Terry's only graded on work she completes and Mary was diagnosed with diabetes. I mean, hopefully that stuff doesn't happen because most of the IEP issues
are not people. That's not, I can't imagine that that's the full spectrum. It may be that the student who has diabetes, their diabetes interferes with her academic achievement, and maybe she misses school, maybe she's hospitalized. You know, I don't know enough about Mary specifically. But if the team has agreed that she's only graded on the work that she submits, there should be something quantifiable in there that student will either reduce work, the student will submit this percentage. That needs to be, I can't imagine that you would see my because these are only graded on what they submit.
In our last couple of minutes, we're going to take our final caller for the semester, and it's going to be Christina calling from Englewood. Christina, we're going to do this quick, so what's up?
Yeah, I don't know if you mentioned it or not, but if the parent refuses their child from teacher services, but by EP plan, will the teacher have to be forced to keep them in the curriculum, the mainstream curriculum?
Yes.
Okay.
Because what the parent has said is that I don't want anything different for my student. So as that teacher,
that's
yes.
What we're doing.
Okay, gotcha.
All right, cool. Thanks for calling me. As we go into about 3 minutes remaining, I first of all want to thank you for giving us 2 hours. I hope that the students understand and appreciate the time commitment, also the knowledge base. So, and I know there were a bunch of questions that people had texted in and we just didn't get a chance to answer. And for that, I apologize, but as we sort of come to the end of this semester, as we've talked about throughout the time, this has been a fairly unique opportunity and experience for me to look into cameras and looking through the book. Next semester as well, there I am. So I get to do one more newscaster turn, as it were. But as we start wrapping up, for those who've turned in your junior achievement pieces, the vast majority of those have been done. All of the midterms have been input. All of the alternative assignments have been done. The participation points should have all been awarded. If you didn't get yours, then please email me in. And then final exam, which will be available to you shortly. And again, my advice to you on this is to take a look at the study guide and make some notes on the study guide prior to going ahead and getting started. And remember, what we know about testing is fundamental. So, if you follow along, if you've read before we've done the telecast each week, your first answer is more likely than not going to be the right answer. I know I'm going to have a large number of you in my 411 course next spring. So what I do want to make sure is that for those of you that have not signed up for 411, which is classroom management, we're going to be doing that actually in person. We'll get to meet some of you, and I'm looking forward to that. But
frozen, you have not signed up for 4-hour class, especially 4-11. I'm hoping you will take the opportunity to sign up and take it with me so we can actually have an opportunity to do several things. Number one is talk about classroom management. Remember, going in the book, we're going to read about Cantor's theory, and we interviewed her right here at this studio this semester, so we'll take a look at that. Also, for those of you that understand the power of feedback, I would greatly appreciate if you would take 10 minutes out of your vacation time to email me with some potential suggestions about how I can improve the performance, because the one thing I'd like to leave you with is when you begin your teaching practices, reflect on behavior. So with that, I'm going to wish you nothing but the best, and I will see you as we pass, and best of luck. It's been a pleasure.